So we're going to have a little look at Bible prophecy today and have a look at some of the current events that we see happening around us in light of Bible prophecy. And obviously this is a lecture series, so we'll have a little look first at what Bible prophecy is and then get into our topic for this evening. So if you're new to reading the Bible or it's something that you're interested in, then we would say as a community of believers that the Bible really is an amazing book. It's the source of truth as far as we're concerned when it comes to how and why we need to live our lives the way that we're instructed and what we must do to attain something better than what this world offers us now in our lives. And sometimes when you come to the Bible, perhaps if you've read it for yourselves or if you've heard some things, it can seem far-fetched. It can at times seem completely amazing. Perhaps the things that you've heard about in the past or the things predicted for the future. And we acknowledge that it does seem sometimes crazy or unbelievable, but we think that God understood this. And so we actually saw in a talk a couple of weeks ago that God has very much made the unbelievable believable through the medium of prophecy. So with prophecy, things that seem crazy or hard to understand often become believable for us in our time and age. And so the Bible has this amazing power of prophecy or foretelling the future. And for us, in many examples, this is actually what's happened in the past and something that we can look at and take examples from. And it shows us that God really is the authority on everything, and there is a proof of his existence. We don't have to examine history too closely, do we? Or even our own experience to realize that human beings have absolutely no knowledge of the future at all. You guys might have an idea of the future. It will involve ice cream for those of us who are in the hall. But outside of that, we're not too sure of the future, are we? We don't know exactly what will happen to us tonight or tomorrow, or on our way to work, or as we start a new week, never mind next year, or what will happen to this world should the Lord Jesus Christ remain away for a number of years. If human beings had the slightest knowledge of the future, how many decisions do you think would have been made differently? How many accidents would have been avoided? How many disasters would not have been allowed to take place? How many wars would never have been started? The experience of our own lives and of the history of the human race really does convince us, doesn't it, that we have no sure knowledge at all of what is coming of our own self. But thankfully for us, there is a place where the future has been foretold, not just once, but over and over again. And for us, as we've said, in many respects, this is the past, and we can see that it was prophesied and fulfilled in the way that it was written. And that same book, of course, is the Bible. And surely that should make us sit up and take notice. In the Old Testament, God writes, look at the suspense. What does he write? A great many things. But he says, behold, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. This is speaking of God's ability to predict the future or to understand what he knows will come to pass. Here's another quote from Isaiah where it says, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish all my purpose. These verses, just a snapshot of the fact that God is in complete control and has an understanding of the beginning from the end. Time is not a reality for God the way that we see it, and so he knows all things. The New Testament makes the same claim for us. When Jesus was about to leave his disciples, his promise to them of the help of the Holy Spirit at their time in the task of preaching the gospel to the word, one of the effects of this gift was to be that he shall declare unto you the things that are to come. And so very much at that time, not for now, they had a knowledge of future events from God. And again, if we were to come to the last book of the Bible, to Revelation, and I don't have it on there, but Revelation chapter 1, verse 1, is declared that God gave, is the revelation that God gave to Jesus Christ. And he says, to show unto his servants the things which must shortly come to pass. And so the knowledge of the future came from God through Jesus. And without this revelation, his servants could know nothing at all. And so I know this is just a few examples from the Bible, picked out to show us the point, but hopefully it begins to paint a picture for us that the Bible says quite definitively that the power to foretell the future belongs to God alone, and he's shown it to us so that we can have faith in him. And again, the reason for that is so that we can see the past and see that all that God has said has come to pass, and therefore we can believe that these unbelievable things he's prophesied for the future will indeed be believable and will come to pass as he has said. And so just for a couple of minutes, what time Brother Joachim was coming in, but I think we've got a couple of minutes just to illustrate from the past some of the events in the life of the children of Israel and how they were prophesied before they happened. And because of that, we can take comfort for ourselves. And so Israel, we know, not only had a varied and unique history, but really an astonishing history as a nation that had been predicted in the Bible in such some food for thought. And we won't go through all of these quotes here, but you can see that before they happened, long before they happened, in many respects, God predicted what would happen to this nation. To keep you all awake, I'll just get you to turn up a couple of these. So if we come to Genesis 15 and verse 13 to 16, we see that when it comes to the nation, the birth of the nation, that this was predicted long before to the founding father, Abraham at this time, but in verse 13 of chapter 15, he said unto Abraham, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and they shall serve them, and they shall afflict them for 400 years, and also that nation whom they serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance, and they shall go to thy fathers in peace, and thou shalt be buried in a good age, and in the fourth generation they shall come out thither, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. And so we see long before they even became a nation, while it was just a family under one person, it was prophesied that Abraham's descendants would become a nation, and that they would go into a land that wasn't their own, and that they would be persecuted, and that they would come out after a certain length of time. And we don't have time tonight, but what we see is pinpointed in accuracy, the family of Abraham's descendants go down into the land of Egypt, where they become a nation, and they serve under that rule for 400 years before they come out, exactly as was prophesied unto Abraham so long before. We see that because of their disobedience, they would be scattered, that Israel would be a continued witness of God's existence. And so they wouldn't be wiped out as a nation or as a culture, but they would be scattered throughout the whole world and yet preserved as a people, and that they would be gathered again into the land and regain control of Jerusalem. And if you have any knowledge of events, you know that the nation of Israel has seen that exact thing happen to them. Even though they've been scattered into all the nations of the world, they've kept their identity. They've kept a unique culture, which is something that can't be said of many nations that have been scattered. That after World War II, that nation was reborn, and in 1967, Jerusalem was recaptured, exactly as was prophesied in the Word of God. And so hopefully that just gives us a little flavor that the prophecies that have been outlined have come to pass. And so it can give us confidence that the things that God predicts for the future can come to pass also. Okay, so let's have a look at some recent events and consider them in the light of God's word. And please take note at this point that as a community of believers, we're not, of course, driven by political means. We don't back any wars or condone any conflict, but merely look at what God has prophesied and see it as evidence of his power, using it as absolute proof of his existence, and therefore the need for us to listen to what he has said. So I think undoubtedly the big news item that we'll all be aware of is the current challenges that face the Middle East, isn't it? The war that is ongoing between Israel and Gaza, and now obviously Hezbollah and Syria and Lebanon to the north as well. And when we consider these things, I've not got a wealth of articles. I'm sure you've seen them or perhaps are aware of them from the news. But Zechariah in chapter 12 very much jumps to mind when we consider what God has said regarding Jerusalem, regarding this area in the Middle East. We see there the words that the burden of the Lord for Israel, saith the Lord, which stretched forth the heavens and laid the foundation of the earth and formed the spirit of man within him. Behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto all people round about when they shall be in the siege, both against Judah and Jerusalem. And in that day, I will make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people or all nations. All that burden themselves with it shall be cut to pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it. And we see this conflict that is often, given a solution name under the two-state solution, surrounding that pivotal point of the city of Jerusalem coming to the fore. And so many nations, you could list them off, and they'd probably be too many to name, that are involved in this conflict, many of them who have no geographic reason to be involved. All these nations are burdening themselves together concerning this city Jerusalem. Have we this region under constant fighting and conflict due to that hold that Jerusalem has on it? And I'm sure we've seen the recent developments that have involved Iran since April 1st, when we saw that those Israeli bombs bombed part of the complex in the Iranian embassy in Damascus. And we saw the news headlines that indicated that those people were killed in that missile attack, including the Iranian general for which retaliation was made. And so in response, Iran on April the 14th similarly attacked Israel in order to exercise their authority in this region. And if we were to have a quick glance, as we did at Ezekiel 38, we could also go to Daniel chapter 11, but we'll stick with Ezekiel for now. We saw, didn't we, in verse 1 to 3, that the prophecy that was written there was concerning certain nations. It said, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief priest, of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him, and say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. And we saw, didn't we, that these nations in a confederacy would come down and would come into the land of Israel. And we've not the time to go into it, but those who were mentioned there were bannered under the banner of Gog. And it says of him, or of them, in verse 2, in the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. And in chapter 39, if you've got your Bibles open, in verse 1 to 2, we say, it says, "Therefore, thou son of man, prophesy against Gog and say, Thus saith the Lord God, Behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief priest of Meshech and Tubal, and I will turn thee back and leave but the sixth part upon thee, and cause thee to come up from the north parts and bring thee upon the mountains of Israel." And we're not the time is said, but if you jot down, or if you're interested, go back to Genesis chapter 10, verse 2, and you see these descendants of one of the sons of Noah, Japheth, and they're scattered abroad, and one of them is Magog, and this land that would eventually be established here. And you can go to various secular records, as well as the biblical Josephus, and we understand that this land that was settled by this particular tribe was in Russia. And so we have Russia presented as coming down from the north with a confederacy that includes many nations. And you'll notice in verse 5, the first of those nations that was mentioned, it says that Persia would come down with Russia. And many people will know that Persia is the historic name given to the nation of Iran. And so we have Iran here involved in the land of Israel with the support of Russia. And so we know from, you know, various sources that Iran very much has a presence surrounding the Russian military in their high command and in their training structures. And so we see that Iran sent these missiles and drones to attack Israel. And what was interesting about that, I'm gonna jump ahead here, is that you may have noticed that when Iran sent those missiles, when they sent the drones to attack Israel, that American and British forces were used to help repel the forces of Iran. The Air Force went and intercepted many of those missiles in order to protect their ally in Israel. And so we see in Ezekiel 38 and verse 13, if you'd come on a little bit, which we didn't read together, but it says, "Sheba and Dedan and the merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof, shall say unto thee, Art thou come to take a spoil? Hast thou gathered thy company to take a prey, and to take away silver and gold, to take away cattle and good, and to take away a great spoil?" And again, we don't have the time this evening. We're just hopefully whetting the appetite. But if you were to look into Tarshish and the young lions, they've always represented the UK and its Commonwealth allies. And maybe, perhaps, we can extend it to the US. I'm open to interpretation there. Not part of the Commonwealth. But we definitely see that these Western allies are presented there as very much in confederacy with Israel and in opposition to these forces of Russia, Iran, Ethiopia, Libya, and Turkey that seem to be coming down along with the help of Europe. And so the pieces are beginning to move, and we're starting to see, even in current events, the fact that we have this standoff between these key players that are outlined for us in these prophecies. And so we see that the war in Gaza is very much bringing these key players together that need to be where they are before the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. Another interesting fact, actually, just before we get there, you might have seen in recent news developments that Israel is saying that we will push into Rafah. It's just in the news in the past couple of weeks. It'll move into the southern city in the land in the territory of Gaza in order to end the war. And if you were to look at Psalm 38 or Zechariah 12, it details how the enemies of Israel will be destroyed. And so it's expected that Israel will eventually move into Rafah to destroy the remaining Hamas base there, perhaps. And all this might add to that verse that we see in verse 8 of Ezekiel 38 there. Because it says that after many days thou shalt be visited. In the latter years thou shalt come back into the land that is brought back from the sword and is gathered out of many people against the mountain of Israel, which have always been waste. But it is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them. And so perhaps it indicates in this prophecy that there may be a short time where Israel will be dwelling in safety before Russia and Iran and Turkey and that Confederate host invades the land. And if you know anything about the nation of Israel or its recent history, very much since the formation in 1948, there has not really been a time of proper peace. And so perhaps these events are leading towards that, if that's how we take these prophecies. Another recent headline that you might have caught or not was Hamas calling for action in Jordan. It's quite interesting, really, because the Qatari leadership that host Hamas, that actually sponsor Hamas to be in its region and flow money from America and Israel to Hamas through its own government in Qatar, are getting a bit fed up, they said, of Hamas. And so Hamas is starting to look where they might go next. And they came out of Syria, so perhaps they won't go back there. They have no real want to go to Iran, although they could possibly go there. And obviously Gaza at the moment is out for them, and Turkey and Egypt have no want. So perhaps Jordan's the next one. But this senior Hamas spokesman was urging its Arab allies to escalate violence against Israel and to aid the terror group in the war that they're undertaking. And they specifically call out Jordan in this, and ask the Jordanians to attack the Jewish state. And this was the first speech in nearly 2 months of a chap named Abu Obeida. And he was demanding that the Islamic world intensify its efforts on all fronts. And specifically there, as we said, it says, we call upon the Jordanian people to step up their action and raise their voices. And he stressed that that Jordan and the Palestinian Authority-controlled areas in Judea and Samaria are the most important Arab fronts against Israel. And it's interesting, really, if you look at it in light of Bible prophecy, because Jordan has long had to balance the pressure from other nations as they've worked with the Israelis over the years. And I don't know if you know, but around 1 in 5 people in Jordan, including their queen, are actually Palestinian or have Palestinian descent. And so the cause of Gaza is very close to their heart. And there's fears in the region as Israel reach out to Jordan. I don't have the news headlines for that. But there's fears that the Jordanians could be dragged into this escalation in this war between Israel and Hamas as it expands into Rafah and its war with Hezbollah in the north. And it's interesting because I'll get you to turn this one up too. If you come back to Psalm 83, when we consider the Jordanians being urged to be part of this conflict, we see these words. I made you turn it up, so that'll keep you awake, but it's also on the screen now. It says, O God, do not remain silent, nor turn a deaf ear. Do not stand aloof, O God. See how your enemies growl, how your foes rear their heads. With cunning, they conspire against your people. They plot against those who cherish you. Very much the state of the world as we see it from the perspective of Israel right now. And it says, they say, come, let us destroy them as a nation so that Israel's name is remembered no more. This is the very thing that was in that news report from the Palestinians there. Come, let us destroy them as a nation. With one mind, they plot together. They form an alliance against you. It says they're the tents of Edom and the Ishmaelites of Moab and the Hagarites. And if you look at If you were to overlay a map that includes Moab and Edom onto a modern day map, then you'll see that the land of Edom is actually the land of Jordan today. And so what this prophecy in Psalm 83 is telling us is that somebody will call out and say, come, let's destroy Israel. And the tents of Edom will be the ones to who they look to form an alliance. And this is this historical land of Jordan. And it's interesting that the Bible uses that phrase, the tents of Edom, because there's actually 2 million Palestinian refugees, the largest number in the world in any location. And they live inside Jordan in these large camps in tents. And so very much the tents of Jordan are being ushered into an alliance against the people of Israel. I could go on for a long time with the news in Israel, but I just wanted to show you that elsewhere in the world, there's also events in the news that really do point towards the prophecies concerning the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. The other, or one of the other challenging conflicts that the world has been experiencing has been the war with Russia, between Russia and Ukraine. And we heard news from Europe now that the conflict is being expanded there. New articles in the last week are reporting that Belarus has moved combat-ready troops closer to the border with Poland. And it says that President Lukashenko has warned that a growing standoff between his country, its allies, Russia, and the West could end in a nuclear apocalypse. And this long-serving Belarusian dictator, you'd say, said on Thursday last week that the troops had been moved from close to Russia to the western end of Belarus. And he said specifically that it was all in response to provocation from the West. It's pressure from NATO that's causing this so-called buildup. And we've seen over the months that the Russia-Ukraine war has strung out that Western allies of Ukraine, the US, the UK, Canada, and many others have sent billions of dollars of aid. Many of them confirming in the last 2 weeks, particularly with the US, even more aid for the Ukrainians. And whenever you turn to the news, this is infuriating the Russians. And it's very much their catalyst for the movement of troops. And we've seen more and more mention from Russia and its allies of this apocalypse that's coming and the use of possible nuclear weapons. And come over to Daniel 11, actually, the other prophecy that we did mention, because we see the similar words that we've already considered, but something that will highlight for us the conflicts that we see from the light of prophecy. Daniel chapter 11 and verse 40. And it says there, at the time of the end, the king of the south, so we established, albeit briefly, that's the US and the UK and all of those allies, it said, will push against him, and that's the king of the north, who would come against them like a whirlwind. And so we see there that word, isn't it, that the whirlwind of the confederacy of the king of the north would come because the king of the south pushes against him. And you see that from the news, that it's the West that's pushing Russia, they say, into this conflict even more. This was just an indication. So we see that the king of the south shall push against him. And this is causing even more Russian forces to be deployed. But interestingly, as we've turned this verse up, another thing that we have seen in the past week is that Russia is deploying even more cruise missile carriers to the Mediterranean Sea. There's now over a total of 20, the Ukrainian Navy has commented. And in an interesting comment is actually a little bit earlier in the month. I'm not going to mispronounce his name, but a lieutenant commander who is the spokesman for the Ukrainian Navy commented that Russian ships had been deploying in the Mediterranean Sea, including the missile carriers that we see, as part of a tactic to expand its military presence in other regions, not just in the Ukraine. And so we see this influx of Russian ships that are coming down, that Ukraine says are for more than just their sphere of war. And what did it say? We didn't read it, so perhaps you didn't know, but in Daniel 11, verse 40, we say that at the time of the end, the king of the south shall push against him, as we've seen, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, with chariots and with horsemen, but also with many ships. And he shall enter into the countries and shall overflow and pass over. The Bible says that following this push against Russia, that the king of the north will come down with many ships, and that it will invade many countries and shall overflow and pass over. And the Ukrainian Navy is saying very much that these ships are being deployed for, quote unquote, regions other than themselves to expand its military presence to other countries. And so we see in our news, in our current events, Bible prophecy before us. And so hopefully we've seen, just from a few snippets there, and some of the Bible quotes that we've turned to, that the prophecies that we have in the Bible are very much coming to pass. That the news around us that we're bombarded with on a daily basis is very much showing us that the nations are aligning to where they need to be in order for the fulfillment of these prophecies to take place before the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in the book of Daniel that we've turned to a couple of times tonight, there's a vision concerning the kingdoms or the nations of this earth and what will happen to them ultimately at the end. And we see the final development of this image of the kingdoms of this world is that what actually happens in those days of those kings, the God of heaven shall set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And this stone that is cut out from the mountain shall destroy and break in pieces and consume all nations, and it shall stand forever. The Bible very much prophesies that the present governments and powers of this world are to be removed in a sudden dramatic event when God intervenes to set up his own government. And to avoid misunderstanding, just so that we know, it doesn't say that the populations of this world will be destroyed. It's very much the power and the authority of man's rule, or its inability to rule, that will be taken away. And instead we see that the Son of Man shall reign on this earth forevermore. The Lord Jesus Christ indicates to us that he will return to the earth to set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed. And it's a frequent theme throughout many of the teachings of Jesus in the New Testament. They agree completely with this, the prophecies that we see, that the Lord Jesus Christ will reign forever. And so what does that mean for you and me? Whether you're coming to the Bible for the first time or whether you've been coming to the Bible to look for answers for many years, we've been set a challenge, haven't we, if we want to look into this. We've been challenged to understand God's word, the Bible. We've been challenged in ourselves to want to follow him and to look for something better in this world than its problems and its trials. And God has offered us a hope, hasn't he, if we believe and are baptized, of a time which will be so different from this time in which we live. And the things in these prophecies are completely at times unbelievable, and yet God has made them believable through the use of prophecy, which gives us the courage and the hope to believe in these things. And so the offer is there for us all, for yourself and for me, to follow after the Lord Jesus Christ, to serve God with all our hearts, and to wait patiently and confidently for his return again to the earth.